Blackstone presents Working 9 to 5, A Women's Movement, A Labor Union, and the Iconic Movie by Ellen Cassedy. Foreword by Jane Fonda. This book is read by Hilary Huber. The worker must have bread, but she must have roses too. Rose Schneiderman, early 20th century garment worker leader. Working 9 to 5, what a way to make a living. Dolly Parton. Foreword by Jane Fonda. I'm an activist as well as an actor, and at times over the years, the two have come together in wonderful ways. That's what happened with 9 to 5. In the early 1970s, I began hearing from my friends in the 9 to 5 movement about the problems women office workers were facing. I heard about the creative ways they were winning rights and respect on the job, and making bosses get their own coffee. I decided to make a movie about what I was hearing, and I asked Lily Tomlin and Dolly Parton to join me. I met with 9 to 5 members of diverse races, classes, and ages, black, brown, Asian, white, young, and old, and listened closely to their stories. They told me about having to perform demeaning tasks for their bosses, training men who would then go up the ladder past them while they remained stuck on the lower rungs, watching their bosses take credit for their ideas, experiencing race, sex, and age discrimination. These women worked hard. They did skilled work and knew the office as well as or better than their bosses did. No business could run without them, and they knew it. Their stories and their fantasies about getting even with the boss all went into the script. The movie 9 to 5 was a 1980 box office hit, and it was these women's stories that made it the success that it was. For the first time, 20 million women office workers could see themselves up on the screen as the centerpiece of a major motion picture. Dolly's catchy, savvy theme song, 9 to 5, became an enduring anthem. 9 to 5 was a comedy with a serious core. Three women get fed up and end up kidnapping their boss. We see what happens when women join together and figure out how to turn their complaints into action. It turns out they can run the company better than their boss ever did. The movement built the movie, and the movie built the movement. That synergy was thrilling for all of us. The 9 to 5 women started out as a group of 10 office workers in Boston, sitting in a circle and sharing their problems with pay, promotions, and the pink-collar ghetto. At first, no one thought women office workers would go on to organize on a nationwide scale. But they did. Their movement was of women, by women, and for women. All kinds of women found a home in 9 to 5. And maybe the way they organized could only have been done by women. They met at water coolers, during lunch hours, and sometimes after work with their children in tow. They used their telephones and typewriters to get the message out. They surveyed, leafleted, and petitioned. They lobbied and rallied. They confronted their employers and public officials to demand raises, rights, and respect. Their meetings, their leaflets, and their picket lines were not quite like anything seen before. Together, they pioneered new strategies for pressuring the powerful and winning a better life on the job. They combined flashy public campaigns with subversive ways for office women to make their voices heard. They gave expression to concepts like sexual harassment and pregnancy discrimination that at the time had no name and were perfectly legal. The women of 9 to 5 understood that the issues of economic and racial injustice must be tackled together because they have the same root causes: greed, racism, hubris. They put the tools of activism into the hands of women workers, and they created a world of new possibilities. In a few short years, they built a feisty nationwide movement that took on the corporate titans and won millions of dollars in back pay and promotions. They lit a fire under government agencies and strengthened the laws protecting women on the job. They started a woman-led union, inspired hundreds of new women labor organizers, and ushered in a new era of organizing. With thousands of members in 24 chapters, they transformed workplaces across America. They changed the image of working women and made it clear that women are not secondary, temporary wage earners, but workers in their own right and with rights. They surprised themselves, and they surprised the world. Their story will move you and inspire you. Prologue. On January 21st, 2017, the day after Donald Trump was sworn in as president.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.